For our next talk, please welcome Dimitris Fotiadis, Senior R&D DevOps Software Engineer at Nokia.
Hello, I would like to thank you all for you coming today to attend this presentation about the Software Quality Evaluation Platform. This is a work in progress, and is based on an earlier solution which is known as Cassandra. It is also a team's work, so I would like to mention here my teammates, Petros Nanouris, Lukas Leondopoulos, Thalia Economou, Marina Kesoglou, Yota Eftaxia, and Panos Karantzias. I would like to thank you all for your major contribution to this project. I would also like to thank Anastasios Bellas and Georgos Niros for their contribution to the creation of the Cassandra tool and their assistance for the continuation of this project within the scope of this platform. So this is the overview of the presentation. Firstly, I will introduce you to DevOps, a very brief introduction. Second, I will mention several augmented intelligence solutions for DevOps. We will try to position these solutions within a sample continuous integration and deployment pipeline. The third and the main section of this presentation is about the software quality evaluation platform. We'll discuss the solution and the design of the quality analytics laboratory. Last but not least, I will present you a short but representative use case of the platform. Finally, I will share with you a summary of benefits, risks, and the future steps that we are going to take. So DevOps actually tries to address the problem that the process of delivering a service from inception to its users is usually an expensive and an error-prone process. The problem is about losing money. The usual suspect here, the IT is frequently the bottleneck in the transition from concept to cash. The symptoms of this problem are usually the release of defects into production, the lack of early diagnosis, blame shifting, long delays, waiting for responses or resources coming from other teams, and of course, frequent manual errors that are introduced throughout this process. But what is DevOps? DevOps is a movement, it is a philosophy, it is actually a culture. DevOps, more precisely, is a set of practices that are used to automate the processes between software development and operations. So they can build, test, and release software faster and more reliably. So the main objective here is to remove the wall of confusion between the worlds of operations and software development. This is done by adding operations into the set of agile development practices to create faster transitions to cash. Culture, automation, lean, measurement, and also sharing are the main ingredients for DevOps. Those are the three pillars comprising establishing DevOps. The first involves infrastructure as code, model-driven automation, and of course, the continuous integration pipelines. The second pillar is about continuous delivery, which is implemented by continuous deployment pipelines. And finally, the third pillar is the one where we actually add operations into the set of agile development practices. This is also known as reliability engineering. The main objective here is to foster a culture of responsibility and create fast feedback paths from production to development. We'll try now to position several augmented intelligence solutions for DevOps within a sample continuous integration and deployment pipeline. I have to emphasize here how important is the DevOps decision support system. It is a major component for our vision as it realizes four strategic themes. one of which is the automated code review. Our pipeline starts with developing the code, of course, and the code should be statically analyzed. I cannot stress enough the importance of static analysis. It is very common for complex and large telecom products to hide thousands of issues at code level. Consequently, the effort that is required to address these issues may be also thousands of working hours. So static analysis is a significant tool for us to attain quality left shift. The code, of course, should be thoroughly tested. And throughout the testing process, we can also perform dynamic analysis. It is a good practice in general to perform testing in advance of the code review process. And this is the first solution that realizes one of the four themes. Our objective is to create fast pipelines without any quality compromisation. In this case, we select and prioritize test case with respect to a specific code change that took place. And here we are. This is the software quality evaluation platform. It provides us with quality analytics, visualization, and specific quality improvement actions and guidelines. We build the code and proceed to several staging testing phases. The third module, realizing a strategic theme, is about continuously monitoring our pipelines to detect anomalies, identify root causes, self-heal, and perform also intelligent log analysis. The Intelligent Resource Manager is responsible to dynamically allocate resources, and the objective here is to optimize hardware utilization, maximize availability, and also perform green computing for cost-saving purposes. And all this constitute a system that attains quality left shift and consists of optimum pipelines. In this presentation, as I earlier mentioned, we'll focus on the software quality evaluation platform. This is a high-level architecture where various quality KPI areas are used to extract data. We merge, clean, and transform the data in order to create quality training datasets. The persistence layer of our solution consists of MongoDB and Neo4j. Those datasets are used as input to a variety of machine learning algorithms. Few of the most popular algorithms are depicted here: random forests, support vector machines, and convolutional neural networks. The inference, decision, and analytics derived from these algorithms is depicted via a dashboard that is available to users for consulting purposes. So in general, the software quality evaluation platform is actually a collection of analytics and prediction models. So the users are able to create custom models, choosing a specific quality KPI to optimize. They are also able to use a platform to create custom state-of-the-art quality KPIs. I have to emphasize here that every instance of the code is analyzed and specific feedback is provided to users. And this feedback is thorough. It includes specific improvement actions. Last but not least, we also provide prioritization capability of these improvement actions. Now we'll try to answer a common, a frequent question, whether static analysis is adequate for continuous quality evaluation and improvement purposes. I will try to answer this question while explaining the continuous quality evaluation and improvement loop process. And this loop starts using a variety of data sources. For example, static analysis, dynamic analysis, test results and log analysis, architecture and design analysis, data persistence quality analysis, and the list continues. There are various data sources from which we can extract quality attributes. During the reporting phase, all this data are collected and categorized according to the origin data source. And data sets are formed and sent into the quality analytics laboratory. This laboratory here is a useful means to create, to automatically create, generate state-of-the-art quality KPIs. Those KPIs can also be generated on demand. Data sets are formed and then are used as input to quality evaluation prediction models. And the inference of that models is then analyzed into a set of quality improvement actions and guidelines. And the developers, of course, are the ones who will act accordingly to maintain and improve quality. So in this case, a dashboard is used to effectively communicate this information with the development team. And this is the continuous quality evaluation and improvement process. Observe that static analysis is only a very small part of this scheme. It is also optional, and do not take me wrong, static analysis, like I earlier said, is really important. On the other hand, I think we have the answer to the original question. It is not enough sufficient for this purpose. We need a much more complex process that is able to represent a complex concept as software quality is. So no, sorry. Now we'll present the common quality metric extraction collection process, the physical extraction process. In this case, we are using a variety, again, of quality KPI areas, and we extract features, quality features, to form data sets, to transform this data into suitable forms for data analysis and machine learning purposes. I have to mention here that this is an independent solution to the programming language that has been used to create the code of our products. So we can claim here that this is a technology agnostic approach. The data sets are then stored to our data persistence layer. And the most important part of this process is that we create mappings between the quality KPIs and specific areas of code, lines of code, that are immediately affected by their values. So our focus is not on creating amazing control variables that will highly optimize the performance of our prediction models. On the other hand, we need to create inferences that can easily be interpreted and transformed into specific actions. We need to provide developers with useful feedback. So, is there a complete set of quality KPIs out there? I think not. There is not, and not even in the literature. Even the quality KPIs we are using are usually old-fashioned and small as a set to represent something as complex as software quality. So in this case, we actually need a platform, the means to be able to create state-of-the-art custom quality analytics and KPIs. We have created actually such a platform. We call it Quality Analytics Laboratory. And the basis for this laboratory are the abstract syntax trees and the code dependency graphs. Those are structures that can represent the code at several detail levels. We store these structures and use them in our laboratory to create quality KPIs. Pattern matching languages such as Cypher in conjunction to MongoDB document query language and the native Java API to Neo4j comprise a powerful toolset for quality analytics creation. So why do we need to represent our code as graph? There are two reasons. First, we need to be able to capture and use data relationships. The second is that this is a very efficient visualization means. And here you can see what is meant us called as graph representation. The nodes here represent code fragments of various scale and semantics. A code fragment that actually represent a class, a method, an interface, a file, or even a module. The color intensity and the size of the nodes represent, depict the value of a selected quality KPI. And also, custom data aggregations could be produced by the code as graph representation. And this is possible via the use of Neo4j and its integrated graph visualization module, which allows us to focus on data relationships. We also have clustering techniques. In this case, we can identify clusters of nodes, that is, groups of code fragments that may be neighborhoods of code fragments or even groups of code that share common quality characteristics. There are algorithms to automatically identify such areas in our structures, and this is called graph clustering, a powerful tool for visualization and analysis purposes. Now I will start discussing a few examples of KPIs and case studies. So this is the world map, and the world map is actually a metaphor for our products. This graph here shows how a deadly virus could spread around the world. We can create similar graphs for our products as well. According to our experience and in practice, it is very common to have areas of code that constitute sources of infection. They do have the bad habit to spread bad quality to neighboring code fragments as well. This solution here is able to identify such sources of infection and eliminate them. And also, code as graph representation helps us to this direction. On the other hand, when changing a code area, we have to be aware of the associated risk. So extra care should be taken in case we change a code area that is fragile in terms of quality. And all this information here can be represented by analytics and KPIs that we can produce and can actually optimize the process of planning and prioritization. This is how we can really attain quality left shift. I will continue discussing some examples of quality KPIs that were introduced by my team. So they are custom quality KPIs that are based on code as graph representation. I would like to mention here that the schematics are just for reference, so I will try to explain the semantics for each KPI. So first we have fault proximity. This metric here defines the distance between the current state of the code and the next bug fix in the code. So in this case, we have evaluated the amount of change that is required to get our first ticket fix. Then we have fault dissemination. Fault dissemination defines how much a specific change affects the quality of its neighboring code fragments. There are cases where we are not aware if a change took place to fix a bug or as a new development within the scope of a feature. In this case, the fault proximity and fault disseminations are not applicable as analytics. In this case, we introduce the change proneness KPI, which actually depicts how prone a code fragment to change is. And the more prone a code fragment is to change, the more fragile it is in terms of quality. We can also predict here the amount of change that will probably take place in the future revisions for this particular code fragment. My final example here is exposure. It was inspired by the scientific area of epidemiology, and it actually shows how much exposed a code fragment is to bad quality. And we can create prediction models using all these analytics as target variables to evaluate their values, to estimate their values, and actually understand a specific viewpoint, quality viewpoint of our products. No one also stops us from creating in the future better and more efficient quality KPIs. And this is the point for having the quality analytics platform. So how are we conducting prediction and consulting? First, we extract data from our data persistence layer, and then we use several machine learning approaches, such as, for example, classification. We can classify whether a code fragment is fault-prone or not, good or bad, with respect to quality. We can also use regression techniques to estimate the value of a selected quality KPI. Clustering is also a useful means for us to identify automatically, as I earlier said, groups of code fragments that share common quality characteristics. This is good for visualization and analysis. And the output of this machine algorithm approaches is usually a prediction model. And this prediction model should be able to answer several questions. For example, how long before we get our first bug fix? How prone our code is to change? How much will it change? How much a code fragment affects the quality in its area? Or how much exposed our code fragment is to bad quality? And so on. If we have the quality KPI, then we are able to use it as a target variable and create a prediction model representing a specific quality viewpoint. But our objective really is to create a hyperset of prediction models in order to be able to efficiently represent the complex term, which is software quality, and be aware of the real current state of the quality of our products. And as I initially promised, I will present you now a short use case that is representative, though. And let us suppose that a developer needs to change a specific code area. He retrieves the feedback information from the model, which determines the current state of quality of this particular code fragment. It also includes, this feedback includes information such as the associated risks and potential code dependencies. Having taken into account this information, the developer proceeds and changes the code. Then again, he receives a new feedback from the model, which now includes the new quality state of the code, but also specific improvement actions and guidelines to maintain and improve quality. The developer, of course, will act accordingly, and the process is finalized when the model is finally happy about the new state of the quality of this code area. And this, again, is how we attain quality left shift. So the main benefit is to support the users without adding any extra effort to their daily routine. The objective is to make their lives easier during the process of producing qualitative code. Also, we establish a continuous quality evaluation and improvement process, and the platform is provided to users to create custom state-of-the-art analytics and prediction models. There are also risks. Data acquisition is a very frequent issue in machine learning projects. Our solution produces vast amounts of data, representative data, which is a prerequisite to build robust prediction models. We also use test data. Another prerequisite is that the products should be thoroughly tested and the complete set of test cases should be available. Finally, we need to optimize the running time of testing processes. This is possible via the test case selection prioritization module that is also a work in progress. So our next steps is to build the feedback mechanism and the dashboard, and of course, evaluate the performance of our prediction models as thorough as possible. I think I should stop here. This could be a cliffhanger for next year's conference. I hope we will be again here to present you a full demonstration of the solution. Also, like I said, this is a work in progress, so your feedback and comments is quite valuable to us. I would like to thank you very much for your attention. Please feel free to ask any questions.
Or is modular code in the context of code proneness a bad idea? Is more modular code in the code?
I'm not sure what is meant by code proneness. You may mean that the code is prone to bad quality, maybe.
I'm seeing people nod their heads, yes.
Okay. So is more modular code in the context of code? I do not think it is a bad idea. However, the basic layer of scale we are using at the moment is on the scale of method or even a class. You may have a hierarchical model here that can actually represents a variety of code layers. So in this case, probably using the approach I just mentioned, you may have even more information, but you will have to create separate prediction models for each layer of code, of module.
Any more questions? I think we're good. Thank you very, very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks.